BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.
New Arts Alive features the guest artists who will share their work for a better understanding of today's art. Program moderator is James Carroll. During the live presentation, the home viewer has the opportunity to call and speak directly with the artist. New Arts Alive is brought to you by the New Arts Program, a nonprofit arts service organization in cooperation with Berks Community Television. New Arts Alive is supported in part by the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, local government, area businesses, NAP memberships, and individual contributions.
Hello and good afternoon. Welcome to New Arts Alive. I'm your host for tonight. I'm Ron Schira, sitting in for James Carroll. And my guest with me tonight is the artist, philosopher, you know, and I would say, you know, deep thinker.
Authentic human being.
Authentic human being, Tullio Francesco DeSantis. And it is a pleasure to have you here today.
Good to see you, Ron. Thanks.
Absolutely a pleasure.
Thanks.
I'm very much enjoying this. Now we're going to, Tullio has quite a extensive history and background in the arts, and it's been, I've known you for at least 30 years, I suppose. So
decades,
three decades, yeah, decades, yeah. So it all adds up to a life in the arts, and a lot of intellectual material coming from this man, which I want to have him share with us today. So, Tullio, tell us something about yourself, like, you know, where you're from, the yada yada, you know.
Well, that's easy. I'm from around here. I was born. Everybody says Reading, but you know the Reading Hospital, which I guess is West Reading or something. Mm-hmm. And so grew up here, went to high school, and Gettysburg College as an undergraduate. Went to the San Francisco Art Institute for an MFA. So that's San Francisco. Mm-hmm. And lived there for during the decade of the 70s. I guess first publication, the first place I did show was at galleries in San Francisco and Sausalito. And then I started to write for the Ripoff Review of Western Culture, which is an underground, art and comics magazine in the
fanzine,
counterculture kind of era. Mm-hmm. And a lot of the people, underground artists that people know, Robert Crumb, S. Clay Wilson, Jim Franklin, a lot of people did work for Ripoff Press. Mm-hmm. And so I like the designation of underground, you know. I think that's good. Mm-hmm. It's kind of like non-mass media or something like that. There, mm-hmm. there is such a thing, even when you're using, you know, mass media. Mm-hmm. So I did 10 years of working gallery art in San Francisco. When you're out there, you think, well, I should be on the East Coast showing, or I should show in New York or something. The San Francisco artists think that. Mm-hmm. So I had a connection here because of growing up in this area, so came back in the 80s, 1980, lived in New York, and had a studio in New York, and lived and taught at Alvernia College. And mm-hmm. so I commuted back and forth between here and Alvernia. Great news flashes about my tenure at Alvernia University. People can do it, some research on that, as it was an exciting time, changed things, got to be a lot of news. Since then, I guess I showed in New York in the 80s, so that was gallery shows. And I guess the decade of the 90s was, I did a lot of work on the internet and just started to show and work anonymously on the internet with in the 90s and the early 2000s. I like that. I kind of like non-traditional galleries to the degree that there are places or ways of exhibiting on the internet that could be considered underground mm-hmm. still, you know.
Do you think that the internet is the only true underground there is right now? I mean that's
kind of. It's always the same sort of free press. You know, there was. Mm-hmm. I mean, in that era, the free presses were, you know, whether it was an mimeograph machine or whether it was the early free press magazines that were around, and then
right.
They
well,
became,
I remember publications like yeah. you know, like the East Village Eye, and,
yeah, exactly.
you know, and Bomb Magazine before it went
exactly
commercial.
Yeah, so yeah. you know, websites for about 10 years, and I guess the early part, maybe 2005 or so, I started to do teach more and teach again and more and. Do the blogs and sort of use my name again and sort of showing work on the internet. So I've been doing that for 10 years or so. There are some possibilities of showing in actual galleries again. You know, I'm looking mm-hmm. at those kind of leads. But for the moment, I'm really happy showing work on the internet because it's such a great way to get your work out there mm-hmm. without any intermediary at all. You know, so mm-hmm. the work is not mediated to other than your own. Work in that platform, whatever you're doing, however mm-hmm. you present yourself in that platform, whatever it is, Facebook, Instagram, on your own website or blog, something
mm-hmm.
like that.
Yeah. Yeah. So that's pretty much basically what everybody uses is Facebook and Instagram, Google Plus, you know, and there's, you know.
Yeah, well, we've been on the internet for so long that, you know, it was AOL for a while. People mm-hmm. think, well, are you on the internet or are you on AOL? You know, are you on the internet or are you on Facebook? I know people in India they want Facebook. They don't necessarily want the internet. They don't know, it's kind of like they say, I want Facebook. You know, they go to the store and buy a tablet, you know, and they say, mm. do I get Facebook with this? And they mean the internet. Mm. And I remember it was that way with AOL. It would be like, you know, the internet, AOL. So yes, there are these different platforms, but you know, mm. we're always using the internet, which is whatever right. the current platforms are that people are using. Mm-hmm. So it's that way. It's publishing work and then hyperlinking to other and with other people, collaborating, you know, worldwide and things like that. I usually collaborate a couple of times a year with somebody, some visual or performing artist.
You collaborated with Dee Shapiro.
Right. There's a piece yeah. of ours together in there. Yeah. And uh-huh. yeah, recently, most recently this year, Dee Shapiro. I like that because, you mm-hmm. know, I like the gender, working with female artists a lot. I like that a mm-hmm. lot.
Oh, yeah. She's quite good, too.
And
Yeah. But did you ever meet Dee? Did you ever?
In real life, no. She's one of the people I haven't. Actually, a great collaborator was Perry Burge, who we did lots of mm-hmm. videos with. She lived in England. And she died without us ever having met. And we have 5-6 hours of video that we did together. So, mm-hmm. again, so it's the new kind of relationship that's over the internet. And, you know, sometimes you meet, sometimes you don't. It's no less real, of course, mm-hmm. since you have a product that develops from it. So
it's a real person at the other end of that
exactly.
line.
Exactly. Yeah. That's the simple answer. Yeah. Media is media. You know, you're always in some form of media, even if it's the sound waves between us. You know.
Right. Well, it's communication. It doesn't matter what it doesn't matter what the vehicle is. You know.
Well, it matters, but you know, we work with it. We kind of use it as you know, poets that originally used sound. They formed sound with the. And they made it sound a little bit unusual. And the painters went down in the caves, and they used whatever the mediums were. We use them, and we try to sort of resonate with what the media mm-hmm. are mm-hmm. today. And I think there's some really cool stuff happening on the internet.
There is. There's a lot of really cool stuff.
Yeah.
I mean, I've noticed that I had belonged to a website called Vloggerheads, and what they did was they depended entirely on the vlog, on you know the put your mm-hmm. selfie, you do the talking selfie thing.
Yeah, video log. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And the most interesting things came out. There's people that are talking in their cars and they're driving. While, you know.
Yeah, it's self-referential, but you know you're creating content, which is mm-hmm. cool. We grew up in a time when most people consumed content, mm-hmm. you know, and so the idea of creating content. Yes, of course, it's self-referential, so much of it, and we notice that part of it. But the fact is that we're kind of, more people are creating the experiences that other people are experiencing, which I think is good. It's kind of, you know, democratizes some of that.
It's even, it evens out.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, because there's so many people out there that are, like when Oprah started getting into it.
Right, well, they're still celebrities. Yeah. I mean, there's celebrities on the internet, there's YouTube celebrities and things like this. They're just kind mm-hmm. of smaller, narrow casting kind of thing.
Yeah. Yeah. But I think that some of the, when you get a really popular person, you know, that gets online,
Well, that's mass media, isn't it? I mean, it's just more mass media, you know.
More hits, more money.
Yeah. So I think it's not necessarily the nature of the medium; it's kind of how you use it and mm-hmm. kind of thing. So, I like to use it in these sort of closely ways that are close to myself, that I kind of get to control everything.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Now about your artwork on the internet. Mm-hmm. So you have right now you're working on a specific series,
right.
Quite a large series, as a matter of fact,
right.
Of drawings.
Right.
And the drawings are originally done with points on paper.
Ink drawings, pretty simple ink drawings, traditional ink drawings.
Yeah. Yes. Mm-hmm. And then you're
either black and white or colored ink.
Mm-hmm. I will be showing a bunch of those probably.
Yep.
And then what you have done also is to have taken that same drawing
and then scanned it into the computer. At that point, it's digitized.
Yeah.
And then it becomes digital art.
Right.
You know, and then it goes mm-hmm. through several simple transformations. I try to keep it simple most of the time.
Mm-hmm.
And so that, you know, what I notice is that any kind of work, traditional work, you know, in different lighting, it's a different work. It's, on this wall, it looks one way. On this wall, it looks another way. This wall. You never quite see the actual work. In museums, you know, the museum intermediates the experience so much that, for me anyway, when I'm looking at something in a museum, I feel sort of a mausoleum-type context. I feel like the weight of art history is on my back, and I'm looking at the work. So you're always experiencing the context anyway, you know, and you're never seeing the work in some sort of pure form. So I don't mind seeing traditional work on the internet. It's fine with me. Most of the art of the world is on the internet. Get used to it, you know.
Yeah.
Yes, I know that it's not the same as thick paint, but, you know, I know what thick paint looks like, too, but... You know, there's something that we get all this, and at this way it's kind of information, and it's everywhere. And so, you know, I bring it into the computer. At that point, it's digitized, just like everything else, mm-hmm. and it becomes digital art, and
mm-hmm.
yeah, get it out there. So there's a mix of stuff that we have to look at.
Okay. So now the artwork itself, what drives this patterning, this positioning, this.
Yes.
This,
why do I do this?
Why? Yeah.
Yeah. Well, it's the simplest way of making a mark, you know, making a point in the present, you know. It's like I'm making a mark.
Mm-hmm.
And then it's not the present anymore. So I make a mark again because it's the new present. And it's not that. So I keep making marks in the present, which is pretty as the simplest thing I can imagine doing.
Mm-hmm.
And what's interesting about that is that those marks in the present, because of the way time works and because of the way my hand works and all this, end up making kind of iterative, repetitive patterns that are sort mm-hmm. of fractal, or they're sort of logarithmic, or they have all these natural relationships just because they come from my hand and they're very simple.
Mm-hmm.
So I like that. I like generating structure, meaning, whatever it is, from a really simple, repetitive process. Yeah, that's.
And what about, is any of this pre-planned, or is it just kind of like, it just spontaneous?
You know, once you get into iconography, then you start thinking about some of that stuff. So
mm-hmm.
yeah, there's. We'll talk about that too. But the iconography tends to stem from these images that are kind of vaguely there. In fact, if there's a, what I'm trying to do is when something starts to look like something recognizable, I'll try not to go that direction. I'll try to make it look like something else.
Mm-hmm. You know, you're veered away from the standard course.
Yeah, I think we tend to like see faces in everywhere mm-hmm. we look and things like that. So when something starts to look like a face, I'll like make it look not like a face and mm-hmm. stuff like that. You know? So it's kind of a way, it's like a Buddhist way of not identifying with things. And occasionally then things, you know, pop out.
Mm-hmm.
But that's different. When you decide to do iconography, which I do sometime, but the iconography kind of derives from these little shapes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because I noticed that some of the shapes that I have seen are really very, very pointed, but they also look like images that you would see on an Aztec wall or an ancient carving in some cave somewhere.
Right.
It's almost like the work has got some sort of subconscious relevance.
I like that.
Yeah,
I like that. Be good, you know. I mean, I think every automatic writer, you know, like. The surrealist writers, Jackson Pollock. You know, you're creating an energy field, and then meaning arises from that field. It can be, mm-hmm. you know, semantic meaning,
mm-hmm.
you know, like, or it could be symbolic or, you know, metaphorical or something like that. And mm-hmm. you have all that in all forms of art. Types of meaning arise from this kind of field of energy that artists create, you know.
The art critic Jerry Salt says that an artist does not own the meaning of his work, and that an artwork...
Yeah, it's a potential meaning. Yeah. It's a field of potential
right,
meaning
exactly.
you create. And
right.
then people see what they're going to see in it. That's culturally influenced, too, the way culture mm-hmm. trains us to see things.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Well, it's, that's pretty good. You want to look at a work or two?
Yep.
Yeah, let's go to the first image here. Now, this piece is called Solstice Day, and this is just the drawing itself.
Yep. Mm-hmm. So now people's screens are filled with images. Is that an image of that? Is
yep.
that the idea?
Yep.
Oh, good.
You see what we have up there? That's
I see.
What, that's
right.
What we
okay. Well,
yeah.
that's how it yeah. works. That's a field of points, mm-hmm. and kind of created by my hand movements. And the hand moving around the paper.
Mm-hmm.
And so I just like the idea that energy and energy fields and relationships and all sorts of patterns and things start interacting and working together mm-hmm. into something that looks like it starts to have dimensionality to it, or infinite dimensionality, or
mm-hmm.
lots of things like that just develop from this process.
Well, it's kind of like staring into the clouds and imagining stuff, because it's like you could almost see like waves and sunlight and different natural patterns, you know, arising out of it. You know, like these squiggles that raise to the top. They can remind me of like water flowing downhill or something.
Yeah, I love
you
it.
Know?
I love all that stuff.
Yeah.
Sure, exactly.
Yeah.
So that's, you know, just keep it that way. People see that and go to the next one. Go ahead. Just.
Okay.
Yeah, so here's the reverse image and flipped around. So sometimes the transformations are very simple, and this one just becomes a black and white negative of the same drawing, and then kind of oriented, flipped horizontally.
Mm-hmm.
The relationships change, and there it's sort of like a pointless white field on a black kind of thing. Something philosophical about, you know, the positive and negative mm-hmm. versions of matter and antimatter or something. So I like to see sometimes these things flipped, mirror image, and so mm-hmm. sometimes the digital transformations are pretty simple.
Mm-hmm. Does contemporary physics and science and
yeah, particles and waves, you know, wavicles, mm-hmm. kind of new paradigms, ways, you know, if we see things that are always recognizable, we'll never see the new thing in it, you know?
Right.
You know, and so the idea is to give you something to look at that you haven't exactly seen before, and then you might see something in it that you haven't seen before.
So you have to take that step into the unknown. It's a really worthwhile project. And you have, you have hundreds of these. Should we go to the next one?
Yes. Oh, that's backwards or something. I don't know, we got to the end of that.
Hmm. Oh, is that it?
Maybe we're going backwards. Try the other way.
Nope.
Oh, we're all out of sequence.
Oh, we're out of sequence here.
Yeah.
So which?
Oh, we're just everywhere. So we'll just talk about
we'll just
things.
Talk,
this is,
oh,
yeah, we'll just talk. Forget the sequence. That's a piece that came from Dee Shapiro. That was her icon in the middle, her iconography.
Mm-hmm.
And I added layers of photos of my paintings and drawings and put them together, many layers. Using her iconography as sort of a biomorphic, organic type iconography,
mm-hmm.
and also working again with a female artist, you know, I start to feel sort of empowered to as feminine part of the art gets you mm-hmm. know employed, and so I used feminine imagery in some of the work that was is related to that. We'll see it at some point.
Mm-hmm.
Like I said, the sequence looks like we're out, so let's just see what comes up.
Mm-hmm. We'll
play randomness
next.
Here. Oh, well, that's related to that, yeah.
Yeah.
It's kind of an opening, it's kind of a button, kind of a tear in the fabric of space or an opening. Things are like vortexes, something
mm-hmm.
like that. The energy field.
Yeah, it's really pretty. I really like it. Maybe pretty is not the right word.
That's a nice word. Yeah, they're all good. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's part of the sort of feminist aesthetic too, which is, you know, all of these kind of handwork things. You know, I love mm-hmm. women artists. They're my favorite artist. You know, Laurie's one of my favorite artists. And this handwork, this kind
mm-hmm.
of, and Dee for the same reason, and very kind of making all of this meaningful stuff with a lot of heart and a lot of soul and a lot of, you know,
mm-hmm.
physical involvement at the same time, you know, thinking deeply and experiencing things deeply.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Would also like to wish the best to Lori Ellison and Lawrence Swan, because they're going through some experiences right now. So
yeah, we wish them their best.
Wish them the very best. Now this one here is.
This is called Consciousness.
This is Consciousness.
And,
this is the one I saw earlier.
It's a color ink drawing, and sort of inverted, so that I know that the RGB inverts of these so that I'll work in green to get like a red or to get a pink. Mm-hmm. I'll use a kind of a light blue, and sometimes they'll flip around the way that I want them to do when I try to go for the inverse in the negative. But, you know, I worked for several years on neurofeedback and have a partner who's a psychologist. We're doing neurofeedback training and stuff. So mm-hmm. a lot of what I'm interested in is kind of consciousness and kind of new brain, new ways of looking at the brain and the mind and things like that.
And the brain waves, like starting out with things like biofeedback.
Yeah.
And things like that. Mm-hmm. Generally, you hook yourself up to some wires that
you get some feedback that tells you whether the state that you're looking for is optimal, if you've attained it or not. And unconsciously, you learn how to modulate your own states to meet mm-hmm. these external cues. And you can do the same thing with brain states, you know. Mm-hmm. So we have software that does that, and I did a couple of years of training on myself doing that. And so I was really interested in that, since that's the basis of our consciousness, it's the basis of mm-hmm. our awareness, this, you know, smart rock that we have inside of our head, mm-hmm. what's going on with it, and, you know, the most complicated piece of matter in the universe.
We have smartphones and smart houses. And
yeah, all that. Yeah, the whole thing, yeah.
Yeah, but... Yeah. Yeah. And about smart people.
And that's we'll just go past the ones we've done before, and we'll hit them all eventually.
Yeah, okay. This is a new one here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, some patterns are different all the time. I like that, too. I'm never too the same. I mean, I'll start and just end up differently, because every day is different. You know, when you're minimal, you know, you notice that you can never do the same thing twice. You can repeat and mm-hmm. repeat, and it's just never the same. And
it's
so,
never the same.
Yeah, so minimalism does provide kind of an opening, you know, that way.
Mm-hmm. You can never put your foot in the same river twice.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So, and notice that the points on this are larger. What is the general scale of these? These are relatively...
They're either 8 by 12, 9 by 12, 11 by 14, small ink drawings. Mm-hmm. I think you have one that's maybe 22 by 30, big old honking thing. Those things take forever to do. And
I love it, though.
I've been doing at least a drawing a day this way. So I get them out mm-hmm. and they scan in perfectly right in the computer. So it's kind of like just work that way. It's mm-hmm. You know, I don't kill them to death by working on big ones, and then I always start a new one, and they're always different. So I kind of like that.
Yeah, I kind of find that the intimate scale of art is becoming more important to me. Mm-hmm. You know, rather than you paint these huge paintings, and like you were saying earlier, you know, like, hey, I know what big gloppy paint looks mm-hmm. like. You know?
It's also institutional. Where you're going to hang that thing, it's going to hang mm-hmm. in an institution somewhere or some
right.
like gigantic hotel or lobby or something.
Right.
Like
so
this place. And so, yeah. You know, something about the internet intimate mm-hmm. experience on the net too. I like that. So kind of do them to scale, do them to size, mm-hmm. size of computer screens.
And that's the inverse of that.
That's the inverse of that. Yeah. Mm-hmm. We'll get to some paintings soon, I think. Mm-hmm. Should be. And then they can be colored. So with these fields, you know, these fields of patterns, they start to feel or find it or some sort of organization within the pattern. So mm-hmm. I'm always adding a layer of organization to what's otherwise randomness. And so what we do with algorithms is sort of mm-hmm. take a bunch of data and then try to find repetitive patterns in it. And, you know, the brain seems to continually be doing that. Life seems to be continually doing that, mm-hmm. you know, whether it's fractal or logarithmic or, you know, some dimensional scale. Life keeps, and the universe, matter, keeps reproducing itself in larger and smaller scales.
Mm-hmm.
So I like to explore that kind of stuff.
Pattern recognition.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, your brain tends to recognize, you know, that stuff automatically, like you just said.
Right, and so if you give it something, if you give your brain something that it doesn't recognize, it kind of keeps things suspended for a while. Mm-hmm. You know, I kind of like that. I kind of like that area where you don't exactly know what you're looking at.
So there's a little bit of timelessness involved there.
Yeah, and also over time, you get to notice things more, too, because, you know, like a painting would be in your your doctor's office, and you'd see it every 6 months, you know, and finally say, wow, I never noticed there was a ship in that painting or something like that. You know, it takes a while to see art sometimes. It takes months to see.
And it's all kinds of art, too. I mean, it's, I mean this is very specific. What you're doing is very individualistic and you know, to you, it's very personal. But there are classical works of art that I have seen 100 times.
Seen new things in it.
Yeah, exactly.
It's slow. It's like a slow medium. Because it builds up in your brain a little bit as you've seen it. You know.
Yeah. Well, I think your brain after a while starts to absorb the maturity of it. I mean, there's a certain level of intellectual bonding that you get. That you have with the artwork, that after a while you get to recognize it. You get to like
right. It resonates with you like a movie you've seen twice, three times, and all of a sudden it's like I like that. It's not just going to be seen that one time. You start to see new things. So these fields and points kind of break up into cellular automata. That happens in nature. It happens in the world. And so maybe it's the beginning of iconography. I kind of look at how does meaning arise in nature. It's sort of this focus of energy, vortex of those energy fields, whether it's gravity or something kind of brings things together, and then they start to relate to each other, and you get a whole universe of discourse that kind of develops from that. So it's kind of starting real simple and then seeing what sort of forms develop from a simple technique.
Right, well, you could fit entire galaxies in these drawings. I mean, the way I look at and I see things like this, I mean, you could look at, if you're going to translate this into something that you recognize, it could be any number of things. It could be, spores.
A microscopic scale and a macrocosmic scale, different. I like that too.
Yeah, the macro, micro.
Yeah.
It all fits together somehow, and I think that's probably the direction that this sort of stuff is taking. My thought is that science and art kind of like walk together, I think. So that, for the last 100 years, maybe a little less, we've had the atomic model, the nuclear model.
Right. And we need a new paradigm to understand what's beyond this and how things work. What other kind of energies and consciousness, we don't understand consciousness. Mm-hmm. And science doesn't understand consciousness. It's called the hard problem of neuroscience. And yet, it is who and what we are. It's the whole core of our experience. And, and so there's a lot of mystery in science as well. Mm-hmm. And so in that area, that's the one I go for. I spent a lot of time in physics as an undergraduate. Mm-hmm. And now I'm real interested in neuroscience because it's kind of like the nanophysics of our time. It's like the new frontier.
Neuroscience.
Yeah.
Well, and particle physics as well too. The idea that anything can be anywhere at any time.
Right. Well, that's the philosophy. That's that's very close to sort of Eastern philosophy. And there's some people. Amit Goswami is a physicist who talks a lot about the how that's very similar to Buddhist thinking and. Yeah, I like that. I like the something and nothing aspects of this new paradigm philosophy.
I mean, you can look at it, and it actually is an experience. The people say that they don't experience anything with art anymore. I disagree with that. I think sometimes art can really put you into a different state. And I've
seen, what you're trying to do is open up your mind, evolve, and have greater intelligence than you had yesterday.
Yeah, I like that.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
Go to the next
keep
one
on
here.
Hitting them. Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah.
So it's iconography. Once it develops, then these shapes are kind of there, all around there. These little shapes, and sometimes they'll just bring one or two of them out and make them the subject of, the piece, the focus of the piece. But there's like thousands of those little shapes in there. It's like I don't know what they are. Sometimes they're biomorphic. Sometimes they look like writing. Sometimes they're calligraphic, and it's just the way meaning arises, and we tend to give them symbolic import.
It looks like you worked on two different artworks in there, because actually the colors in the circular central part. They don't have any black in it, so you is this a digital piece?
Or
is
no,
this,
that's actually what the piece looks like. That's just black and white, black ink on white, and then colored ink.
Ah, okay.
Yeah, just colored ink. So that's the original.
So you use pens and markers for these?
Mm-hmm. Yep. Mm-hmm. And there might be maybe the inverse of this one next or something before or after it. Yeah.
There we go.
So you take it in the computer, scan it, flip it around, invert the RGB colors, and everything like that. Yeah.
That is so cool.
And so now it exists in virtual space. You know, can be projected any size. I like that. Can be. Mm-hmm. You know, it's, you make prints. You know, it's just I like it because it's electrons at that point. You know, you have now transformed the thing into you've digitized it. And once you've digitized it, it's no longer a piece of paper. It's now a bunch of relationships. You know, I like that information. So,
yeah, I like that. That's interesting.
That's the idea.
Well, that's the kind of like the conversion of art into you know, this the new media. The new
right, and everything's going there. You know, our medical records and everything else.
Yeah,
it's all being digitized. So,
My iPhone keeps asking me to you know to sign into the cloud.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Right. So this is all in the cloud, and that's what we're doing. So it gives you the opportunity to digitize your work, put it in the cloud. And, you know, whatever, it'll be downloadable forever, you know.
Yeah, to anybody, really, though. That's the only thing.
So you have the sense, a cosmic sense, I'm speaking to the ages, you know, beyond that, some other galaxies, you know, other times and space, dimensions. I like that. Just keep it open. You know, I like what the Internet does. It's not a new idea. I like T.R. Deschardin. He was a Jesuit philosopher. He had this idea of the new sphere, kind of the thinking layer around Earth, you know, composed of all our thoughts. Mm-hmm. And it was kind of precursor of the Internet, but now we have it in, you know, wires and cables.
I've kind of viewed the whole thing of consciousness as being this gigantic pool.
Yeah, it's a network. We're networked together.
Is overlaid over physical reality. You have like this, you know, this sort of conjoining reality, which is thought.
Right, and because we're networked, it kind of follows the rules of networking. This kind of group nodes develop around different topics and different thoughts and things like that. So yeah, it's great. So it's just a neat way to think, and we're learning that these points and these lines, these points and relationships start to make patterns that are intelligent patterns. There's some sort of intelligence there. Mm-hmm. DNA is one, right?
DNA,
it's kind of like a pattern that continues a code. Through it.
Yeah, well, there was a statement that was going around a while ago that thought has no DNA. And I don't know if that's exactly true.
Aren't those memes? Isn't that the meme idea, maybe?
Yeah, yeah.
You know.
So that thought does have some sort of way of
transmission.
Transmission.
Yeah, and replication, sure. Yeah. See what else you got on there. See if we can find some paintings. These are all drawings.
Oh, okay.
Let's go. Yeah, these are altered drawings. Taken in just like that.
Do you want to go for another one?
Yeah, go ahead. So on the wall of the studio there, that's just a scale. So small drawings, some small paintings. And if I hit another one, maybe you get a little close up of the paintings. So at a certain point, these things, I like to get the icons, I like to get the points, I like to get the work from the drawing and then embed it in like layers of sand and acrylic and glitter and material. Mm-hmm. So that kind of like gets it back into being a part of the earth or part of like a slab of rock or on the side of a cave wall or something. I just like that, again, to like materialize these things which were once. So the sand paint, once a year I'll just go back in the studio and do these paintings which are kind of covered with sand and then have lots of points and lots of patterns and color and all that. And so it's about time to do that soon.
Mm-hmm. So, and there's a big one there. I like that these paintings have a sort of a double imagery to it. It's like you have this sort of cloudiness in the background or not cloudiness, but more or less a different pattern that it sort of exists underneath the pattern that's on top.
Right, and then the pattern emerges if you look at it for a while.
And then the pattern emerges. Right. I mean, and then you see I'm all for seeing patterns in the air, you know?
I love it, yeah. So, well, these also have glow-in-the-dark a layer, and they also have a layer of a black light. So if you change the light, then you get a different pattern. Like I like that idea, too. And then they glow in the dark, you turn the lights off, and then has a different pattern. So, you know, once again, it's like, what's the real painting? What's the actual painting look like? Well, it depends on the light. And that's the idea. Once again, it's the same. The medium. You ever notice how a same picture looks different on a different phone or on a different screen, a different computer? Mm-hmm. You can never see the same thing. Different book. You know, we learn these illustrations when we were young, and then you see a different version of it. It's just all there. You never get to see the pure thing itself. You see a version, you know, a version of it.
Yeah, but does it really, by seeing the digital image of it, does that really take away anything from really what the artwork is about?
I think that's all you ever, this is the problem of phenomenology. I mean, it's the, our relationship to the external world, you know. Mm-hmm. Are you ever seeing directly, or is your seeing always mediated, you know? It seems to me that very mediated experience.
Very mediated experience. Yeah. Well, it's mediated regardless because...
Right, culturally.
Culturally, you're looking through...
Bias.
Filters of...
Right, cultural bias.
Yep,
big
cultural
one.
Bias, you know,
yeah.
experience, education,
yeah, exactly.
You know?
Let's
see.
So we could just talk in general if you like. We've probably looked at a bunch of these.
Yeah, okay. Well, what about any upcoming plans for you? Are you...
Yes, there seems to be some interest in showing my work again publicly, and so I'm looking for venues. Mm-hmm. You know, have an agent, someone working, and people looking, and so maybe something will develop soon.
We hope, yeah.
Yeah.
Because always,
it's nice to be able to drive somewhere and talk to people and talk about your work.
To meet new people.
Been using the studio for that a lot lately, you know.
Well, I
people
like
over to the studio. But I love this. I love showing work on in these media, you know.
Mm-hmm.
You do want to reach out. You do want to like communicate. You know why do the work? You know, I was telling my friend, a psychologist, solipsism is not true until you die.
that's funny.
And you find out all along it was true, and it was just you.
It was just me. Yeah, nobody else ever existed.
Right. But before that time, at least you know you have this relationship thing going on with other people.
Right.
You know, and so it's part of it's a communicative act, you know. And so I try to shoot a really long arc, you know, like in Jodie Foster in Contact, you know, way out there. I like to shoot for like a long distance audience. I don't, you know, I'm not so totally concerned with like right now, you know, the audience of what things are doing. You can see how mixed up it is. People, there's a lot of people looking at zombies, you know, there's a lot of people, you know, eating brains, you know, this is they're playing video games. It's a lot of stuff that, like, I think we could probably maybe grow out of eventually, you know, so that we don't have to have all this stuff in the cloud, you know what I mean?
Right.
For our artificial intelligence to sort of pick this up all the time.
Right.
I'm interested in sort of purifying this or changing this. But it's a long shot because right now we're just, you know, we're not so subtle.
Right.
Our interests are not so subtle.
Well, you're working in kind of a middle ground here then.
Mediating.
Mediating the mind and the art. And the media, yeah.
That's interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's great, yeah, because I have to say that I'm really impressed by your work, so I really like what you're doing right now. So, because for a couple of different reasons, because it's broad-based, it's not just totally centered around art. And I mean, art can become very incestuous and very, you know, very competitive and you know, not really approaching, you know, the true parameters of what art really is.
I like the philosophical part of art. You know, I hope people get that. You know, I always thought Keith's work was very philosophical, very
You had a very good strong relationship with Keith Haring.
Yeah, one of the people I collaborated with, Keith Haring. Yeah, also from around here. Very strong relationship to art. Allen Ginsberg, a strong relationship to philosophy. Keith was well steeped and really interested in philosophy. Allen Ginsberg had a deep understanding of Eastern philosophy. And, you know, I would like people to just understand that there's things to be thinking about while we're being entertained and, you know, while all this is going down. Several strands of American or of world culture now, but of culture that haven't been explored in a long time. You know, they're legalizing psychedelics out there now, and so you have a bunch of kids who really don't have heroes like we had to look up to that understood, that had been there before. People, you know, so I met Timothy Leary, I got him to come to Gettysburg College, I wrote to him, you know, and Allen Ginsberg became and these people who you feel connected to going back generations before you, who are some sort of an underground movement. Mm-hmm. And, you know, today, people don't quite have that. They're kind of disconnected, and you have these celebrities who are out there, but nobody's really talking philosophically. So it would be good to...
It would be good to kind of jumpstart that. Yeah, I do agree with that. I think that there should be a lot more talk about things that, you know, that surround art, you know? I heard it expressed one time that, you know, if you wanted to talk, you can talk about something and refer to something without even saying what it is.
Well, artists, you know, referred to itself for such a long time has been this, like, incestuous kind of thing of art relating to other art, artists relating to other artists, critics, and, you know, the larger dialogue is what's the relationship of you know, consciousness? What do these marks mean that we're making on the wall? What is the meaning of this? What is the meaning of it? Why are we doing it? You know, and what are we trying to do? So you ask some of those kind of questions, you're in philosophical territory, you know, and art can address those as it always has. I think it always has.
There's a conceptual end to it, too, because I remember at the New Arts program once you had an artwork up there that I really, really had to laugh. The name of the artwork was Kissed Wall. And
Kissed the wall.
And you just kissed the wall and you named it.
That's right.
Bravo.
You know. That's right.
That was great. So you know, but I mean that's a lot of what it is. I mean it's applying that thing of, you know, like, well, loving art, you know. Well, you have to love the wall because the wall holds the art, you know. So you give the wall a kiss, you know. So
yes.
I mean it was all of that. You mean and that's the humor of it. That's the fun of it.
You see some humor in my work. That's good. But people think it's real serious.
Real serious?
Yeah. Well, you see the humor in my work?
Yeah, we'll have to teach them. We'll have to bring them up to speed.
You know, yeah.
All you out there. Do you want to look at some more?
I don't know. How are we doing on time? I haven't looked.
We have about 17 minutes.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah.
That's
really good.
Sure.
Yeah. We'll look at a couple more.
Flip on something. We'll think of something else to talk about. Mm-hmm. Here are these symbols and ciphers kind of turned into... a lot of these were done really directly from things that I did in the studio. I was real interested in... being able to make things day glow, ultraviolet, glow in the dark, all these lighting effects. And I found that I could get these kind of effects in on the computer if I started out with the opposite kind of RGB colors, and then just intensify the colors and finally get to a point at which they started to look like the paintings that I was doing in the studio under black light. And I kind of like that. So this is just a group and a listing of these glyphs or icons. Don't know what they mean. Icon is a real, everything's an icon today, you know, Hershey bars and Hershey kisses and, you know, everything's an icon. Yeah. But they all have meaning, or quite a simple meaning. So this idea of they carry some sort of meaning.
Right. Well, I mean, all you have to do is look at the curve, you know, of a sneaker and know that it was done by Nike. I mean, they've got you trained.
Those images, those symbols, they activate the same part of our brain as the religious fervor does. They put a group of nuns, this is a scientific research project, nuns volunteered for meditating on things like the Sacred Heart and the Rosary, on their prayer, deep contemplation, deep religious meditation. Mm-hmm. And they imaged parts of the brain with fMRI. And then they had people look at Nike logos and Lexus logos and things like that. And the same part of the brain is activated. Mm-hmm. And so we know we have this very powerful symbolic, the power of symbols is very deep inside of us, you know. Mm-hmm. I usually draw a silhouette of a hawk and usually tell students that, you know, this imprint, there's neurons already, little chicks are born with the imprint of the hawk, the set of neurons, so that when that shadow goes by, they're already afraid of it. They're built right in, you know.
Yeah, it's genetic, yeah.
Yeah, it's because those are the ones that survived, that just happened to have that a sensitivity to those kind of shapes, you know, promoted their survival. So very deep inside of us is this identity relationship survival thing we have with these symbols that somehow we create and we become, you know, it's like our beliefs. You can't demonstrate your beliefs, you can simply... believe them.
Yeah. Coming also to teaching, because you mentioned students. you teach at Reading Area Community mm-hmm. College, right? And you teach art there.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
But a lot of the, you know, I'd love to be, I've been in your class. The generalized concept of the work itself is to incur the student to be an artist and not so much to teach them art. I mean, you teach them how to make something. You can teach people how to make something, but you can't teach them how to think. I mean, you could teach them. You have to like.
Well, this is a question. This is your thought. You're asking me about I'm teaching art, or tell me what's my approach to teaching art.
What's your approach to teaching art? Yeah.
What are we doing? What do artists do? You know, yes, it's more than how to hold a football. There's more to football than how to hold a football, right? In the first day, first day of practice. Yeah, it's the same thing. It's more to art than how to hold a pencil. You know, it's not about how you hold your pencil. Something about it is how you hold your mind, how you hold your brain. We do a lot of relaxation exercises in the beginning. We do a lot of things before we pick up the pencil. Mm-hmm. It has to do with, you know, the state of mind that you're in. I think that's the first thing, is that art has to do with this state of mind. You know, if you're making a great piece of furniture and you've done it perfectly well, and you've every screw and every joint is all perfect, that's a great work of craft and technique. And, you know, there's a Lamborghini is a great work of craft and technique. There's something else about art, you know, art is something else. Mm-hmm. Some people think it's about vision, about this idea about vision, but it's a state of mind. Mm-hmm. And if it's a state of mind, then how do we achieve these states of mind? And
right.
And so you talk about meditating, you talk about relaxation, and mm-hmm. you know, so I think there's something about the creative state of mind. So I teach the creative state of mind, I think, if that's what I'm teaching. That relates to your question, because you were searching for what's the theme or what's the subject, and I think it's about the state of mind, is the creative state of mind. Sort of be in the moment, you know, to not be accepting so many preconceptions, cultural biases about the things you're looking about the experiences you're having. Mm-hmm. And, you know, once you do that, you start to notice, you know, very subtle, very quiet things, and then you can start to pay attention to objects that you might want to be drawing or something. But you know, it's all about getting in that state of mind. Mm-hmm. And so that's the dimension of making these points, you know, thousands and millions of these points, which is a meditative process. So, you know, my art reflects that. It reflects a meditative process. So everything is good. Yeah. Everything is good. It's exercise. It's all exercise, mm-hmm. you know.
So, is there anything that that we haven't touched on, maybe?
We want to evolve, you know. We want to be better than we were yesterday, you know. And, you know, art's a vehicle. It's kind of like a vehicle. It can transport you because it has possibilities beyond your current understanding. Mm-hmm. That painting or that piece of work that you looked at yesterday could have meaning untold tomorrow. So it's this ability to create a text mm-hmm. that is not completely circumscribed today. Whereas, you know, scientific texts, this is what we know now. Art is something else. It's something, this is what we might know tomorrow. So you need to keep mm-hmm. an open mind about what you're experiencing. Mm-hmm. I like that. It's a kind of way of keeping open to the future.
Do you think it's more existential? It is more existential?
It is.
You know,
absolutely it is. Yeah, and that was the idea, the philosophical quest. It's mm-hmm. a philosophical quest, I think, for, mm-hmm. you know, people call it spiritual. I just don't use the word because, you know, I went to Catholic school. I had a bad experience. I don't know what it was, but I just don't use the word.
I don't use that word either. Yeah. I don't like spiritual.
A lot of people use it, but, you know, to me, mm-hmm. it's something else. I use philosophical as a substitute. It works. Mm-hmm. People, mm-hmm. they know what I'm talking about. I know what they're talking about, but,
right.
you know.
Right, I don't know about the whole spiritual scenario. Just kind of like, it's just
you get caught up in those symbols. You know, you get really caught up in it. It's the symbols are a little too sticky for me. I like the symbols to be. It's very clear that they are not the final word, and that they're mm-hmm. kind of in flux or something. We don't know the final. We don't have the final word. You know.
Yeah, well, a lot of it too is that we've been there and we've done that. You know, it's like how. Long have we used religion?
Yeah, mankind, sure, yeah, of course. Yeah. It's time for new paradigms,
it's
a new ways of looking
at
things. Yeah,
it really is. I agree on that. I'm not saying.
And I think always art has presented the new paradigm. It always has. Always has. Somehow, you look back. That's why we remember it, art history. That's why we created it. It creates the new paradigm even before people understand what it is. You look back and you say, hey, that was the new paradigm.
Yeah, but I think, too, that we, you know, maybe the new paradigm, I guess what I'm saying is that this is not to say that it's anti-religious.
No, not at all.
No,
I think it's the same, exactly the same thing.
Yeah.
I'm talking philosophy, person's talking religion. We know, that person knows what I'm talking about, I know what they're talking about. We're probably talking about the same things, I just don't use the word.
Okay, yeah. We don't want them getting on television and saying that we're after them.
Yeah, I just don't use the word. It's just my preference.
Should we look at a couple more pieces? Because we have about 4 minutes left.
Sure, see what comes up.
That's
all sorts of things can develop from these shapes. And what's interesting about it to me is that if you go down, the idea of a fractal is that if you take the larger piece and you go down deep enough, you'll find that a reflection of that larger piece in the smaller piece.
Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
so generating all these kind of patterns, large scale, small scale, they're just reproduced on a larger scale. So they start to jump up and they sort of become forms on their own.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes
it's like almost like you're isolating a little section of eternity.
A little section.
Mm-hmm.
And it becomes sort of a field, kind of an energy field. And
wow, that's awesome.
You know, so particles and waves, and it was the definition of matter, material, and energy, and consciousness, and all that.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm very happy making one mark at a time. It's infinite possibilities doing that.
Well, that is a form of tantric meditation, you think?
I think so.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, really what it is the...
You're channeling your energy. You're using your body to channel your energy. It's kind of rising. Yeah, absolutely. Isn't art always that? I mean, it is always that. I think Pollock was doing the same thing, wasn't he?
Mm-hmm.
Through his body. You know, when they asked him, he said, I am nature. It's the same way you are. You are the natural process. And this is what comes out. I think you slow down and just kind of one step at a time, one mark at a time.
Mm-hmm.
And relationships, certainly mystery is there, and there's a lot to wonder about. I like that.
This is beautiful. Stunning.
Yeah, see, and I like how they look on TV and on the screen and all
great.
That. Yeah, so they're kind of made for that. So that's
exactly. They're made.
They're flat and they're colorful and
You could. There you go. You could actually make like a screensaver program.
All that stuff. So many things are possible. It's just it's great. You just kind of do it and it's out there and I love it. It's all over the world.
Okay, well, we're back to this, back to your collaboration and that. I think we showed everything then.
Yes, we did.
Okay.
Thanks, Ron.
Well, wow. We've hit the end of the show just about. I think they're going to give us a goodbye sign any second here. But anyway, I want to thank you.
Mm-hmm.
I want to thank you for being
good.
My guest.
Good conversation.
We reached a lot of the good points here.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks for the opportunity.
My pleasure. My absolute pleasure.
All right, good.
Yeah. So that's it. Okay. So thank you very much for joining us on New Arts Alive. I'm with Tullio Francesco DeSantis. I'm Ron Schira, and we bid you good night. Thank you.
New Arts Alive is produced through Berks Community Television and can be seen live on the second Tuesday of each month at 5 p.m. Consult your local community cable service for live and repeat programming. For more information about the New Arts program and its consultation residencies of artists from the literary, visual, and performing arts, call 683-6440 or write New Arts Program, P.O. Box 82, Kutztown, PA 19530. Or visit the office and exhibition space at 173 West Main Street, Kutztown, PA.
Hours are Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, 1 to 5, Saturday, 10 to 2, or by appointment.
B BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.